Hello everyone, welcome to the second module. We had exciting discussions in the last 3 days on essential newborn care. Now in the next 3 days, we go on to discuss delivery room management. The transition from mother's cozy womb to the difficult environment outside is a challenging experience for at least 15% of the deliveries. And it is here that you and me make a difference. So this golden hour management can make or break these babies. We have a great team from Sri Ramachandra Medical College, Chennai to lead this discussion on NRP. The team is led by two good friends of mine, Professor Dr. Prakash and Professor Dr. Uma. I welcome all the members of the faculty team to this group. Friends, now let's learn the delivery room management.
Presentation, we are going to see foundation of neonatal resuscitation. The objectives are why neonatal resuscitation skills are important, the physiological changes that occur during and after birth, the format of the neonatal resuscitation program flow diagram, the communication and the teamwork skills used by effective resuscitation teams. Which babies requires resuscitation? Most of the babies are vigorous. Only 10% of the newborns require some assistance. Approximately 4 to 10% of newborns may need positive pressure ventilation, and only less than 3% of newborn may need major resuscitative measures like intubation, chest compression, and medication to survive. Why do newborns require different approach to resuscitation than adult? In adult, the cardiac arrest is a complication of trauma or existing heart disease. It is caused by a sudden arrhythmia that prevents the heart from effectively circulating blood. As circulation to the brain decreases, the adult victim loses consciousness and stops breathing. At the time of arrest, the oxygen and carbon dioxide content of blood usually normal. During adult cardiopulmonary resuscitation, chest compression are used to maintain circulation until electrical defibrillation or medications restore the cardiac function. In contrast, most newborns require resuscitation have a healthy heart. When a newborn requires resuscitation, it is usually caused by a problem with the respiration leading to inadequate gas exchange. Respiratory failure may occur either before or after birth. Before birth, fetal respiratory function is performed by the placenta. If the placenta is functioning normally, oxygen transfer from mother to the fetus and CO2 is removed. When placenta respiration fails, the fetus receives insufficient supply of oxygen to support normal cellular function and the CO2 cannot be removed. The blood levels of acid increases as cells attempt to function without oxygen and CO2 accumulates. Fetal monitoring may show decrease in activity, loss of heart rate variability, and heart rate deceleration. If placenta respiratory failure persists, the fetus will make a series of gaps followed by apnea and bradycardia. If the fetus is born in the early phase of respiratory failure, tactile stimulation may be sufficient to initiate spontaneous breathing and recovery. If the fetus is born in a later phase of respiratory failure, stimulation will not be sufficient and the newborn will require assisted ventilation for recovery. The most severely affected newborns may require chest compression and epinephrine to allow the compromised heart muscles to restore circulation. At the time of birth, you may not know if the baby is an early or a late phase of respiratory failure. After birth, respiratory failure occurs if the baby does not initiate or cannot maintain effective breathing efforts. In either situation, the primary problem is lack of gas exchange, and the focus of neonatal resuscitation is effective ventilation of the baby's lung. Fetal physiology. What is happening in the fetus? So before birth, the fetus lung do not participate in gas exchange. All of the oxygen used by the fetus is supplied by the mother by diffusion across the placenta. CO2 produced during fetal metabolism is transported across the placenta and removed by the mother's lung. The fetal lungs are expanded in utero, but the potential air sacs, the alveoli, are filled with fluid instead of air. Pulmonary vessels that will carry blood to the alveoli after birth are tightly constricted and very little blood flow into them. In the placenta, oxygen diffuses from the mother's blood into adjacent fetal blood vessels. The oxygenated blood leaves the placenta through the umbilical veins. The umbilical veins travels through the liver, joins the inferior vena cava, and enters the right side of the heart. Because the pulmonary vessels are constricted, only small fraction of blood entering the right side of the heart travels to the fetus lung. Instead, most of the blood bypasses the lung, crossing to the left side of the heart through an opening in the arterial wall, that is patent foramen ovale, or flowing from the pulmonary artery directly into the aorta through the ductus arteriosus. Blood in the aorta supplies oxygen and nutrients to the blood fetal organs. The most highly oxygenated blood flows to the fetal brain and heart. Some of the blood in the aorta returns to the placenta through the two umbilical arteries to deliver CO2, receives more oxygen, and restart the circulation. When blood follows this fetal circulation path and bypasses the lungs, it is called right to left shunt. So what's happened after delivery? So lungs expand with air. Fetal lung fluids leaves alveoli and filled with air. So transitional circulation, the baby breathes, pulmonary resistance decreases, blood travels to the lung, gas exchange occurs in the lungs, blood returning to the left side of the heart from the lungs has the highest oxygen saturation. So what is happening in the transition? So transition from the fetal to neonatal respiration, there are three important physiological changes that occur during this transition. So first one is the baby breathes, umbilical cord is clamped, separating the placenta from the baby, which results in the newborn uses the lungs instead of the placenta for gas exchange. So second one is fluid in the alveoli is absorbed, result in air replaces the fluid in the alveoli, oxygen moves from the alveoli into the pulmonary blood vessel, and CO2 moves into the alveoli to be exhaled. The third one is air in the alveoli causes blood vessels in the lungs to dilate, which results in pulmonary blood flow increases and the ductus arteriosus gradually constricts. So the pulmonary vessels dilate, the pulmonary blood flow increases, which results. So the baby's initial cries and deep breaths helps to move fluid from the airways. In most circumstances, distension of the lungs with air provides sufficient oxygen to initiate relaxation of the pulmonary blood vessels. At blood levels of oxygen increase, the ductus arteriosus begins to constrict. Blood previously diverted through the foramen ovale and ductus arteriosus now flows from the right side of the heart into the lungs, and the fetal right to left shunt gradually resolves. Oxygenated blood returning from the baby's lung travels to the left side of the heart and is pumped through the aorta to tissues throughout the body. What can go wrong during transition? Lack of ventilation of the newborn's lung results in sustained constriction of the pulmonary arterioles, preventing systemic arterial blood from being oxygenated. Prolonged lack of adequate perfusion and oxygenation to the baby's organ can lead to brain damage and damage to the other organs or death. What are the clinical findings of abnormal transition? Irregular or absent respiratory effort, that is apnea, or rapid breathing, that is tachypnea, slow heart rate, bradycardia, or rapid heart rate, that is tachycardia, decreased muscle tone, low oxygen saturation, or low blood pressure. So what is primary apnea? When a fetus birth first becomes deprived of oxygen, an initial period of attempted rapid breathing is followed by primary apnea and dropping heart rate that will improve with the ductal stimulation. So what is secondary apnea? If oxygen deprivation continues, secondary apnea ensues, accompanied by a continued fall in heart rate and blood pressure. Secondary apnea cannot be reversed with the stimulation, so assisted ventilation must be provided.
It is often difficult to assess how far into the process the newborn is. If the baby responds to stimulation with breathing, then it is likely early in the process. If not, it is likely in secondary apnea. In general, the longer in secondary apnea, the longer it will take for spontaneous breathing to resume after resuscitation. However, as soon as ventilation is established, most compromised newborns usually will show a very rapid improvement in heart rate.
Next, we move on to neonatal resuscitation program flow diagram. The NRP flow diagram describes the steps that you will follow to evaluate and resuscitate the newborn. It divides into 5 blocks, beginning with birth and initial assessment. Throughout the diagram, diamonds indicate assessment and rectangles show action that may be required. Although it is important to work quickly and efficiently, you must ensure that you have adequately performed the steps of each block before moving on to the next block. Assessments are repeated at the end of each block and will determine if you need to proceed. This is the NRP flow diagram. Initial assessment: determine if the newborn can remain with the mother or should be moved to a radiant warmer for further evaluation. Airway: perform the initial steps to establish an open airway and support spontaneous respiration. Breathing: positive pressure ventilation is provided to assist breathing for babies with apnea or bradycardia. Other interventions like CPAP or oxygen may be appropriate if the baby has labored breathing or low oxygen saturation. Circulation: if severe bradycardia persists despite assisted ventilation, circulation is supported by performing chest compression coordinate with the positive pressure ventilation. Drugs: if severe bradycardia persists despite assisted ventilation and coordinated compression, the drug epinephrine is administered as positive pressure ventilation and chest compression continued. So next we move on to pre-resuscitation team briefing. The first step in preparing for resuscitation is planning how your team will be contacted and how will respond. Who will respond? Once assembled, each team member needs to understand his role or the task he will be assigned. Perform a pre-resuscitation team briefing before every birth to review the clinical situation and the action plan. During the briefing, assess perinatal risk factors, identify a team leader, delegate tasks, identify who will document events as they occur, determine what supplies and equipment will be needed, and identify how to call for additional help. Next, post-resuscitation team briefing. Performing a post-resuscitation team briefing reinforces good teamwork habits and helps your team identify areas for improvement. A quick debriefing can be performed immediately after the event, while a more comprehensive debriefing may be scheduled a short time afterwards. Your debriefing do not have a find major problems to be effective. Your team may be identify a series of small changes that results in significant improvements in your team performance. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Mohammed Asif, senior consultant in SRMC, the Department of Neonatology. And today, this topic of this session is about preparation for birth. So how are you going to prepare for your delivery sessions? That's what we are going to see now. The objective of the session is, what are you going to learn? You will be learning about the risk factors that can help predict your baby's outcome, which need resuscitation or not. How to assemble and how to assemble a resuscitation team. How are we going to organize a resuscitation team? Okay. The next is, we have to get some answers for some four questions, the basic questions from the obstetricians before going for a delivery. And how we are going to perform a pre-resuscitation team briefing. Team briefing means we have to allocate people. We have to design a working model. We have to have a team leader. And we have to allocate some systematic way of doing the resuscitation. So one should be allotted for a bag and mask ventilation part, and the other should be one person will be engaged in doing a chest compressions if needed, and one person may be allotted for doing a documentation of things and everything like that. The timing on documentation, the medication timings, doses, everything has to be documented also as and when needed. And one person can be allocated for putting a UVL and giving medications if needed. And one more thing is we should not really forget is how to assemble and check the equipments, especially the bag and mask the equipment. These are the four free birth constraints. What is the expected gestational age? Is it a term gestation or a preterm gestation? And is the amniotic fluid clear or not? Is it meconium stained or clear like? How many babies are expected? Is a singleton or multiple gestation? And any other additional risk factors, say like mother will be having PA hertz, which she may be a diabetic mother, cardiac conditions may be associated. All these questions we have to get an answer before going for a delivery. Team briefing. I told you already, pre-resuscitation team briefing is very, very important. You have to assess the prenatal risk factors. We have to know about the mother's conditions associated and the baby's condition as well. Twins or singleton or whatever, everything we should be knowing in detail, and identify a team leader. We have to identify a team leader, and we have to usually follow what the team leader says. And we have to delegate the task. Task means we have a ventilation part to be done. We have a chest compressions to be done and medication part. Somebody should put a UVL and somebody should give medication. Some documentation should be done. So all these tasks should be delegated to the particular, some assigned person, so that there will not be any confusion while doing the resuscitation. Clear? And identify who will document the event as well. So documentation is much, much important. When is the heart rate, when was the heart rate dropped to 60? When was the medication given? How long it took for the heart rate to come back? All these things are very, very important for the future outcome. And determine what supplies and equipments are needed for that. So based on the single, if it's a singleton or multiple gestation, preterm deliveries, maybe a CDH baby, whatever it is, you design a equipment module and accordingly you arrange everything from A to Z. Identify how to call for additional help. So in case the team is so short, maybe in a peripheral setup, the team will be very short. In that case, we have to always have a standby additional help. Some case consultants should be available nearby, something like that. So you should have the mobile numbers, ambulance facilities, all these things should be kept in mind before going for a highest delivery at least. Hand washing, all this team briefing is over. Now we are just going, entering the labor room or operation theater, whatever. We usually do hand washing as guided by the WHO. It's 6 steps, a total of 2 minutes. All should be knowing about the 6 steps. Hopefully, I know you all know all. And preparation of the environment. Once you enter the delivery room, make sure the temperature is very ambient for the newborn baby. Okay, it should be preferably kept between 26 and 28 degrees centigrade. And if needed, you can switch off the fans and ACs and everything, or windows if can be shut to avoid any convection loss for the newborn baby. Preparing the resuscitation corner. Just go to the resuscitation corner. Not necessarily it may be utilized, but in case of resuscitation, then if the baby needs a resuscitation care, then probably we have to shift the baby to the resuscitation corner, preferably a warmer. So switch on the warmer at least an hour before the expected time of delivery. Say it is going to be like another 30 minutes, you keep the things ready before 30 minutes itself. Keep it in the manual mode and heater output to the maximum, and make sure suction apparatus is working. And make sure the oxygen source is also ready. Checking the equipments. Checking the equipments can be done systematically so that we will not miss anything, whenever it is needed. So keep it in mind, it should be systematically checked. For warmth, what are the things we need? For clearing the airway, for auscultations, for ventilation, for oxygenation part, what are the things we need? So all these things should be in mind. And for intubation, and for medications. All these things has to be checked systematically. Probably the work may be allocated to one or two people. Not necessarily the same person should be doing. We can allocate the things for a different people who are really going to be in the scenario. For warmth, what are the things we need? We need a preheated warmer. I told you already, it has to be switched on. Warmer has to be switched on at least an hour before the expected time of delivery. So we should have a preheated warmer, and we have to put 2 warm towels under the towels or blankets under the warmer. And temperature sensors, sensor cover should be used for prolonged ventilation if it is needed. Hat, plastic bag or plastic wraps, the baby is going to be less than 32 weeks of gestation. And thermal mattress, if it is available, can be utilized if it is going to be a preterm baby. Clearing the airway. For clearing airway, usually bulb syringes, bulb suckers are usually nowadays is not recommended actually. And we use 10 French or 12 French suction catheters attached to the suction wall. And the pressure needed should be set between 80 to 100 and not beyond 100 millimeters of mercury. And meconium aspirator, if needed, can be utilized. On auscultation, we should have a good quality stethoscope. And ventilation, giving ventilation, positive pressure ventilation, we should have a flow meter set at 10 liters of oxygen per minute. Oxygen blender, if it is going to be a preterm baby, less than 35 weeks, we may give up to 30% even in the initial setting itself. So we can have a oxygen blender, which is preferential, especially in a preterm baby. And positive pressure ventilation device, that is PPV. We usually call it as AmbuBag. It should be there. And term and preterm sized mugs. Term and preterm sized mugs, 0 and 1. And 8 French feeding tubes and large syringes to decompress the stomach if the baby needs prolonged ventilation. So positive pressure ventilation device, the PPV device, I'll tell you later about how to check it and everything. Okay. So when are you going to start the PPV? The baby's apnea, or when the baby is not having gasping type of respiration, we have to start with PPV, or maybe associated with the heart rate of less than 100 beats per minute, even if the breathing is there. So these are the indications to start with PPV, and if there's a persistent cyanosis despite 100% of free flow oxygen. So, and one thing we should remember is, ventilation of the lungs is the single most important and most effective step in cardiopulmonary resuscitation. So ventilation is the most important step. So we should be very, very thorough in doing a bag and mask ventilation. So general characteristics of resuscitation device. What are the characteristics of resuscitation device? Because the baby differs, so the baby's size differs, the baby's gestation differs, the baby's conditions differs. So based on that, we have to design a resuscitation device. The appropriate sized mask, preferably a anatomically shaped and cushioned mask is preferred, and variable oxygen, I mean, the control of peak inspiratory pressure and inspiratory time can be managed with whatever the device we have. Preferably TPs and all, we can use it also. In size of the bag, preferably it should be like 500 ml bag we usually use. Maybe in a preterm baby, you can go for a little lower volume bags. Safety features to prevent high pressure slavery. This is very, very important. So all the resuscitation devices should be provided with the safety measures. So the bag and mask equipment, once again, frames, it should be cushioned and preferably and shape, anatomically shaped. And sizes, we have different sizes, small base, I mean a zero size for a preterm baby and size one for a term baby. Checking the AMBU bag. So how are you going to check the AMBU bag? So you can just keep the AMBU bag in your, once you are tight, fitting the that face mask and everything tightly into the AMBU bag, just keep it in your palm. Just give some compressions. Bag should be self-inflating immediately after compressing the bag. Once you compress and leave it, the bag should be self-inflating immediately. And we should just look for it. And while the second point is, while compressing the bag, we should feel the pressures on our palms. That means the air is entering through the air in outlet, comes into the baby's systems. So that's what it implies. And while compressing the bag strongly, we should hear the hissing sound at the pop of valve. That means the pop of valve is working, and we will not allow much of air getting into the system of the baby to avoid pneumothorax or air leaks or whatever. So all these things has to be checked in mind. Kept in mind while checking the AMBU bag, and it should be completely kept ready before going for delivery. So this is the way how we have to test the self-inflating bags. Okay. So feeling the pressure in our palms while giving compressions and hearing a hissing sound at the pop of valve, so that the excess pressure is getting out of it, and self-inflation of the bag once it is released. So these are the three things we need to the amount of pressures delivered depends upon the following three factors: how hard the bag is squeezed, so it should be very gentle depending upon the baby's lung conditions or whatever, and any leak between mask and newborn space should be avoided, and set point of pressure release, the pressure release valve should be in a working condition. These are the things, and depends upon the baby's lung condition also. The self-inflating bags, the advantages are it always refills after being squeezed immediately, and it is always inflated. It gets inflated immediately. The pressure release valve makes overinflation less likely. So the possibility of pneumothorax or air leak syndromes are less likely with the self-inflating bag if the pop off valve is working properly. Disadvantages of self-inflating bags. Bag will work without a gas source, so ensure the oxygen is connected. Sometimes if the baby needs chest compressions, we have to go for a higher concentration. That time the oxygen source should be connected with the bag and mask. So it should be always kept in mind. It occurs tight face mask seal to inflate the lungs. The face mask should be tightly compressed, applied on the face, baby's face. Okay, so that may be sometimes causing some injuries to the baby's face. Okay, so oxygen reservoir to provide high concentration of oxygen and cannot give free flow oxygen through the mask. Free flow oxygen cannot be given through the mask and cannot be used as a CPAP machine also, because it cannot deliver PEEP. And TP is resuscitator. This is another mode of giving a resuscitation in the labor room itself. The advantages are consistent delivery of the pressures. We can have a consistent delivery, so we can apply for CPAP also, and reliable control of peak inspiratory and positive end expiratory pressures. So it's quite reliable and very easy to use also, and a reliable delivery of 100% oxygen. So we can adjust the oxygen as a need based on the baby's condition. No fatigue from bagging. We keep on doing bagging for some time, maybe some 2 to 3 minutes. It will be easy to use TP resuscitator than a bag and mask ventilation. Disadvantages: it requires compressed gas source, so it can definitely have a compressed gas source. Then only that TP resuscitator works. Must have tight face mask seal to inflate the lungs. Complaints of the lung cannot be felt. Complaints of the lung cannot be, we cannot assess the complaints of the lung. Requires pressures to be set prior to use. So prior to use, we have to know the requirement of the pressures. Accordingly, we have to set it. But not necessarily, it should come always coincide with the baby's needs. Changing pressures during the use is more difficult. So this is also one of the possibility. Disadvantages in TP resuscitator. Safety measures, once again, a pressure gauze and a flow control valve, and or maybe is usually preferred, a pressure release valve should be in a working condition. These are the safety measures we usually follow in any resuscitation with all these devices. So safety measures, I told you already, the pop-off valve will not allow much pressures to enter into the lungs, baby's lungs. So that will be very, that is one of the safety measures in what we use in labor room, that is bag and mask ventilation. TP resuscitator, there is a valve mechanism to set a maximum pressure, something like that, in TP resuscitator. So that is one of the safety measures in this system. So how are you going to apply the face mask? So the face mask should be applied covering the tip of the chin, mouth, and nose. So signs of effective ventilation. You have started giving the effective and positive pressure ventilation. So how are you going to assess whether it is effective or not? The signs of adequate ventilation. Good ventilation is improvement in the heart rate, color, and muscle tone. The frequency, how are you going to ventilation? 40 to 60 breaths per minute, 40 to 60 breaths per minute. And it should be very rhythmic, So how are we going to maintain the rhythm? We will say breathe, 2, 3, breathe, 2, 3, breathe, 2, 3. While saying breathe, you will compress the back. And 2, 3, you will relax the back. So while saying 2, we will be compressing it, and while saying 2, 3, we will relax it. So that's how we have to give the bag and mask ventilation. So if the infant is not improving, even after adequate ventilation, the infant is not improving with heart rate or saturation, whatever, even after adequate ventilation, what are the possibilities? The seal may not be proper. It's a seal, inadequate sealing of the face. The airway may be blocked. There may be secretions blocking the airway, and not enough pressures. We may not be giving sometimes very sufficient pressures to inflate the lungs. So this is the normally used AmbuBag. The basic parts of the AmbuBag, most of the people are knowing it, but still I would like to tell it. The self-inflating bag has seven basic parts. The oxygen inlet, to which the oxygen catheter has to be connected while giving a concentration of more than 21%. That is oxygen inlet and oxygen reservoir. If the baby needs 100% oxygen, probably we need to add on a separate oxygen reservoir. There's a kind of a plastic bag called as oxygen reservoir. We have to add it on in the back of the bamboo bag to deliver 100% oxygen. And air inlet. There are two valve systems. One way valve that may be located at the either end of the bag through which gas inflows after compressions. We are giving compressions. The rear air inlet will allow the air inside, and the other end valve will allow the air to go into the baby's systems. Pressure gauze or pressure gauze attachment site. Pressure gauze, a small hole or projection near the patient outlet to measure pressure given to the patient. A manometer can be attached with the pressure gauze. Pressure release valve, pop-off valve. It prevents excessive pressure building up in the bag so that we can avoid pneumothorax. The valve assembly, just positioned between the bag and the patient outlet. It's between the, we call it as fish mouth valve. Patient outlet is the end part of the ambu bag where the mask or the endotracheal tube has to be attached. And for oxygenation, for coming to the oxygenation part, we need equipment to give free flow oxygen. Some free flow catheters or can be attached to the face mask and given. Pulse oximeters with sensors and covers. Target oxygen saturation tables. Target oxygen saturation tables. Based on that only, we have to decide how much oxygen to be given or whether we have to go for a CPAP support or something. And for intubation, we need laryngoscope with size 0 and size 1 straight blades, stellate if it is needed, optional only, endotracheal tubes of sizes 2.5, 3 and 3.5, carbon dioxide detector. It is most of the times not available, but if it is available, you can use it also to decide whether it is in the inside the trachea or not. Measuring tape. For endotracheal tube insertion depth table, whichever is available, you can use it. Waterproof tape or tube securing devices, plasters to secure it. Scissors, laryngeal mask, if it is available, you can use it instead of intubation. Medications. We need to have epinephrine. That has to be diluted to 1 in 10,000 dilution, and the dosage is going to be 0.1 to 0.3 ml per kg. Epinephrine, what is available is 1 in 1,000 dilution. Take 1 ml of epinephrine, add on 9 ml of saline to make it as 1 in 10,000 dilution. That may be used as a stock solution and can be, what is the dosage is, what is the usual dosage is, 0.1 to 0.3 ml per kg. And saline. And when you feel there is a hypovolemia in this baby's system, we can opt for giving a saline bolus also. So saline bolus, the dosage is 10 ml per kg per dose. 10 ml per kg per dose, saline bolus. Saline, normal saline should be there. And other supplies for putting in, I mean, umbilical venous catheters. Some four or five, six, seven frames can be used to put a UVL. And finally, it's optional, electronic cardiac monitors, if it is available, can be used at the labor room itself. And to sum up, this is a checklist of the instruments needed. And whatever is available in your vicinity, you can use, make use of it. But sometimes, so this is the list of all the equipment needed. And whatever is preferable is something have to, we should not miss it. And whatever is optional, we have to keep it in options only. Say like cardiac monitors and all, it may not be available in all the units. If it is available, you can make use of it. So this checklist includes only the most essential supplies and equipment needed at the radiant warmer, nearby the radiant warmer for most neonatal resuscitations. So whatever is available, whatever is needed in your baby, and it may be unit specific also, what is available in your unit, you can make use of it and ensure that an equipment check has to be done properly prior to going for delivery. Thank you so much. Thank you all.
Hi everyone, I'm Dr. Prabha, senior resident in neonatology and specialist in child developmental unit in Srihar. I am today taking a topic on routine care in NRP program. The steps involved in the routine care includes all the five steps, starting from providing warmth to the baby, and this is drying the baby from head to foot, and then wiping out all the secretions from the mouth if at all is there, and then followed by the mouth, nose also should be wiped clean, and the cutting the cord in 1 to 3 minutes, then keep the baby with the mother. Skin to skin care has to be established after the cord is clamped to effectively continue the warmth, and the initiate breastfeeding by placing the baby prone between the mother's breast. So these all five steps are very essential to be done soon after the baby is delivered and given to the neonatologist. By the time assess the baby's breathing, color, activity, and the tone of the baby during the interval of cord clamping. The delayed cord clamp, as I have mentioned, it is the time interval of clamping and cutting the cord as soon as the baby is delivered for a period of 1 to 2 minutes. So the preterm newborns have the benefit of decreased mortality. There is a high blood volume pushed into the circulation from the placenta to the umbilical vein. There is less need for blood transfusion as a result of delayed cord clamp, and there is a lower risk of necrotizing enterocolitis. Then in a term newborn, there is a decreased chance of iron deficiency anemia, and furthermore, there is improved neurodevelopmental outcome in the subsequent periods. And what are the adverse effects? It delays the resuscitation for compromised newborns, and there is increased risk of polycythemia where there is more blood pushed into the circulation, and hence there are RBC volume increases and then resulting in jaundice as well. This is a labor room scenario wherein the baby is received soon after the baby is born. After a minute of time, the cord is clamped and the baby is put over the mother's abdomen for a quite period of time, wherein the skin to skin contact is established and the baby is put prone over the mother's abdomen, wherein even the breastfeeding can be initiated as soon as the baby is delivered. And here, the vitals also can be monitored simultaneously as a breathing pattern, change of any color, a heart rate, as well as the temperature. And the next is the observational care, wherein it is indicated when the baby is breathing well and the heart rate is more than 100 required positive pressure ventilation for less than a minute. So these babies will be going for observational care, wherein the following steps are generally done. Here we are providing warmth to the baby as the first the drying of we are first drying this baby from head to foot, then followed by that changing the next towel and wiping clean and observing the breathing and temperature, as well as initiating the breastfeeding. Watching for complications, if any, like convulsions, lethargy, poor feeding, and respiratory distress. I will monitor the vitals like breathing, heart rate, color of the baby, and the temperature check every 30 minutes for 2 hours in the observational ward. Here the baby is going to be kept along with the mother, the same in the rooming in as well. Thank you.